I'm Rod Serling. You're listening to The Zero Hour. Rest your eyes. Exercise your imagination. This week, Kenneth Fearing's study of a deadly obsession. Desperate Witness. Starring Richard Crenna. Lewis's production of The Zero Hour. This week, a tale set in the frenetic, high-pressure world of big business, where the individual is a desperate single figure at the mercy of a ruthless organization. This is the story of George Stroud. He has a choice: reveal himself and expose his fraudulence, or attempt to cover his tracks and run. For George Stroud, the choice is out of his hands and into those of the big clock, that impersonal, bloodless symbol of time. George Stroud is about to become both the hunter and the quarry. Our story, Desperate Witness, begins after this word.
She was tall, ice blonde, and wearing a hands-off sign hung on her by the great Earl Janeth. If I'd been smart, I'd have given her a wide berth. But then if I'd been smart, I'd be the head of an international publications conglomerate, and Earl Janeth would be working for me. But I'm not so smart. I returned her cool nod, and I filed away for future reference the invitation in her eyes. And it all led to murder, with me caught in a web, trapped, and running for my life. I first saw Pauline Dulles at one of those parties Earl Janeth liked to give in his minor palace in the East 60s. To impress investors and moguls and to keep reminding his staff how lowly they really were. My wife was at my elbow, dazzling a group with quick conversational footwork.
Sorry we're so late. We couldn't get away from President McKinley. Did you know our 24th president at the bar of the Silver Lining? Well, that is, tonight he was McKinley. Sometimes he's Justice Holmes, Thomas Edison. He has an earthly alias, but I've forgotten it. When he's very drunk, he's Abe Lincoln and he frees the slaves.
She's some lady, my wife. You'd think with a magnet like that, a man would stay put. But there was another, more powerful force in that room. I tried not to look at Pauline Dulles, but I could sense everywhere she was. 100 or more people drifted in and out. Old wine and new bottles. Old conversation and changing faces. When it was time to make the last train home, Earl Janeth emerged from somewhere, and Georgette and I said our goodbyes.
Well, glad you could come, Stroud. I'm delighted to see you, Mrs. Stroud. You should always wear polka dots.
I'll go home and put spots on everything, like a Dalmatian.
No. More like a pinto pony.
Watch out for your boss, George. He's turning my head again.
My pleasure. Believe me, dear lady, my pleasure. Good night.
Good night.
Too bad you were late, Stroud. You missed Major Conklin. He likes what we've been doing recently with crime waves, and I told him that you're the moving force there. He was quite complimentary.
Oh, sorry to have missed him.
Oh, that string of graveyard magazines he just absorbed. He wants to activate them, but I explained to him I didn't think a man, of your precision mentality could advise him. He needs a geomancer.
It's been a pleasant evening, Mr. Janet.
Well, it has. Good night.
Like a whip, Janeth turned and left. We were dismissed. Well, let's grab this cab. Grand Central.
Well, did you think so, George? I had fun. You don't really like working for Janeth, do you? I don't believe in forcing square pegs into round holes. Neither do you. Cost is too high. I mean, well, sometimes it seems to me we were much happier when we had the roadhouse. Weren't we? For that matter, it was fun when you were a racetrack detective. Even the all-night broadcasting job. It was crazy, but I liked it.
I'm executive editor for Crime Ways magazine, and we're halfway to a down payment on that piece of land you like.
Hey, your lipstick's all worn off.
Then you might as well kiss me. George, what's a geomancer?
Oh, I don't know. Georgie Janet got it out of the fattest dictionary printed. He wrote it on his cuff, and now the rest of us know why he's a boss. Yeah, remind me to look the word up. I would look it up and drop it into my conversation sometime. But it wouldn't satisfy because he'd had it first. As he had everything. My wife's head on my shoulder, and still I couldn't get Pauline Dulles out of my mind. Was it only because I wanted to take something away from him? The question was put aside by the big clock. Time. Pressing. And you're the mouse, scurrying around and across the intricate wheels and balances. Cobweb mazes, false exits, dangerous blind alleys and steep runways, natural traps and artificial baits. Money for the true opening. A real prize. And the clock strikes and it's too late, and you're a prisoner again. Locked up 9 to 5. And now I am looking in the mirror at a half-shaved face, practicing what I'd like to say to Earl Janeth. Look here, Janet, we really got to do something about getting me more money.
Well, I thought, George, that you went over this whole thing with Steve Hagen months ago.
He said to talk to you, you said to talk to him.
Yes, you and Steve settled it, right?
How'd you like it if I took something away from you, huh? Something priceless, something exquisite, something you bought and paid for.
George! Honey, come down, your waffle's getting cold.
Janet Enterprises. 29 floors of publication, syndication, circulation. Stop by any corner newsstand for the full smorgasbord. Weekly, monthly, quarterly. We put them all out. Newsways Magazine, Commerce, Sportland, Plastic Tomorrow, Personalities, The Sexes, Future Ways. 26th floor, Crime Ways. That's me. In theory, we're the nation's police blotter. In practice, we're one of the biggest circulations of Janet's empire because everybody's fascinated with crime. Which is what my associate editor, Roy Cordette, and staff were discussing when I got in that morning.
Dozens of people are murdered every day.
But he's a criminal.
Morning, George.
Good morning, Roy. Leon.
Good morning.
Good morning, Ed.
George, we're talking about the mass murder outside of Reading.
I tell him we ought to run that story. It'll sell 6 million copies.
Yes, Leon, but is it for Crime Way?
Yes.
Hours pile on top of each other while we juggle stories of murder, rape, robbery, analyzing what sells, what doesn't. Sociological research, parole board reports, decisions of the Supreme Court, interspersed with fights with our budget department and a temperamental photographer. It's 6:15 when I escape my desk after the inevitable phone call home that I'd be late for dinner. The babysitter informed me that my wife had gone to her sister's in Trenton on some emergency and might not be home till morning. So there I was. At about 6:30, I walked into the Silver Lining, sat at the bar alone, studying my face in the mirror, replaying my imaginary conversation with Janet about a raise. He still said no. I told him where he could go, and I had another double shot.
I must run, darling. You coming?
No, not yet.
Well, it's lovely seeing you. Enjoy the drink.
Bye.
I didn't have to turn. The mirror gave me the picture. Two expensive, chic women, one brunette, one blonde. The brunette gathered up packages from Saks and Bonwitz and left to brighten someone's evening. The blonde stayed. She smiled at me. Pauline Dulles.
Hello.
Oh, hello there.
Join me?
Oh, why not?
You remember me, don't you?
Vividly.
I remember you. You're a friend of President McKinley, and this is where you met him, right? Is he here tonight?
No, his real name's Clyde something. No, he's not here tonight in any of his disguises.
Oh, that's too bad. I was looking forward to it.
Well, you don't want to go out with McKinley. He was assassinated. Safer going out with me.
I wasn't worrying about being safe.
Well, you've come to the right place. We had 3 margaritas. Or was it 4? Pushed our Mexican food around our plates. She made a phone call to clear her calendar. I finished a drink I seemed to have in my hand, and I too made a phone call to the understanding manager of the Lexington Plaza, who just happened to have an unobtrusive room for us. We walked to the hotel. I knew I should turn back, but I couldn't. I'd stepped off the deep end. Buzzing and hammering were in my head. The room was harder to figure out. It was an arm's length away. A telephone. My brain finally sorted out the message. Hello?
I'm sorry, sir, but you don't have a reservation for today.
My eyes focusing now, but barely. Showed me an impersonal hotel room, two glasses, an empty scotch bottle, my clothes, and me.
There's another party checking in. The hotel is filled, otherwise we wouldn't disturb you, sir.
Her perfume was there, but she was gone.
Checkout time is noon.
Now, what time's it now?
1:30.
In the p.m.? I developed skill at lying those next weeks, and I stayed in town more and more. There was a sense of adventure finding different temporary abodes. Once we spent a weekend as far away as Albany when my wife and daughter were away and Janet was in Washington. Got to be a game, thinking up different names for the register.
I'm sorry, sir, your handwriting. How do you pronounce it?
Phelps Guillon, Mr. and Mrs. Andrew Phelps Guillon.
Yes, sir. I hope you enjoy your stay in Albany.
The Phelps Guillon enjoyed every moment of it.
George.
Mrs. Phelps Guillon, you are the last, final, beautiful, ultimate enigma.
And I thought it was your art collection that you cared about.
No collection. I do have quite a few Pattersons.
I never heard of him.
Her, Louise Patterson. You know what you are? Ignorant. Ignorant and beautiful and threatening and destructive.
You're a dangerous man, George Stroud.
Me? Kittens get belligerent when they see me coming. They sharpen their claws.
It is dangerous to know you.
Quit thinking about Janet. There's nothing to be afraid of. He doesn't own you. He doesn't own me. Now drop Janet. Those moments came up and passed, like the night and the morning and the long drive back to the city. And the constant, insistent pull of the big clock saying the interlude's over. I couldn't let her go. Not quite yet. We walked, reluctant for our time together to end. A window shopping antique store. Some still open, hoping for a last-minute sale of a night crawler. It was in the window of a cluttered corner shop that I saw the painting. Just two hands, one receiving a coin from the other. Unframed, dust-covered, curled at the edges, but unmistakably a Patterson. I was inside. Pauline trailed as the shopkeeper lifted the musty canvas out of the window and handed it to a big, sloppily dressed monolith of a woman with a voice that could cut steel and a face to match.
Ha! It's in rotten condition. Not worth much. What do you want for it?
I don't know. Make me an offer. 15, 20?
20? There's not a quarter's worth of paint on this crummy thing. I'll give you 5. Take it and be grateful. 5.
$50.
Hey, I'm buying this picture. Get your hands off it. Who do you think you are just because you got money? Lousy painting, nothing but a couple of hands. Not worth 50.
I've made my bid, 50. Can you match it? It was obvious she didn't have the money, and I couldn't have cared less. The shopkeeper was licking his lips for the 50. The last Patterson I'd bought cost me $900, and it was considered a bargain. I paid him in cash. Pauline thought I was crazy. At the cocktail lounge of the Van Barth, we stopped for a nightcap, and we argued about the value of the painting. Even in the dim, candlelit saloon, I could tell my 50 was a good investment.
The Hands of Judas. No, the Temptation of Judas, that's what we'll call it.
Yeah, but Judas got 30 coins.
Just the same, it's Judas. 30 coins or one.
Oh, okay. The Temptation of Judas. Shall we drink to that?
Oh, I'm sorry, George.
The dedication was delayed. Pauline's drink was all over the table. I rescued her with my handkerchief, then I called the waiter to clean up. We moved to the bar, we drank to the Temptation of Judas, and we left. It was just past 10 when we came out of the Van Barth. I drove the few blocks to 58 East, Pauline's apartment. As usual, I parked well away from the entrance. And as always, when I brought her home, I felt
uneasy at the risk we were running. I got out of the car. I handed her the small overnight bag she'd taken to Albany.
It was all beautiful, George. Beautiful.
She kissed me and hurried away. Beyond her retreating figure, I vaguely noticed a limousine pulling at the curb opposite the building's entrance. There was something familiar about the posture of the man who got out of it. He put his head back into the car to issue instructions to a chauffeur who drove away. Then he turned for a moment in my direction. In the light that fell on his face, I saw that it was Earl Janeth. He looked directly toward me and followed Pauline into the building. I didn't move. I stayed hard-pressed back into the shadows. My job, my future, my family, all up for grabs. If he had recognized me. I heard him call out her name before the door to the building closed behind them.
Pauline!
Had he seen me, recognized me? Would she tell him about me?
Pauline! Now, look, you saw me. Why are you pretending you didn't see me?
Earl, dear, don't be cross. It's late.
All right, dear, I'll ring the elevator. You don't have to do it for yourself.
The doorman's never around. I've learned to do these little things.
Yes, your overnight bag. Shouldn't he have brought it in if he were any kind of a gentleman?
Did you have a nice trip, Earl?
I didn't care about Washington. And you, did you have a pleasant weekend?
It was marvelous. I went riding and swimming. I read a grand book, and I met some of the most interesting brand new people.
Was he one of them?
One of whom? Oh, you mean the brand new people. Yes.
What did you do together?
Darling, please, let me get inside and get my shoes off. Make yourself a drink.
Where did you go with them?
Tonight? Well, first we went to a terrible place on 3rd Avenue by the name of Gill's. You'd love it.
Yeah.
Kind of a combination archaeology foundation and saloon. It's really weird. After that, we walked up and down the street shopping for antiques.
Antiques?
Mm-hmm. Finally, we bought a painting. At least he did. In a shop about 3 blocks from here. It was an awful old thing. Looked like it had just come out of a dustbin. He practically kidnapped it from another customer, some woman who bid for it, too. Nothing but a couple of hands by an artist named Patterson.
A couple of what?
Hands, darling, just hands. A picture about Judas. After that, we went to the Van Barth and had a few drinks, and he brought me home. That's where you came in. Satisfied?
Interesting itinerary. Seems it would take more like a weekend than an evening.
We moved fast.
Well, who is this fast-moving, brand-new person?
He's in advertising. Name's George Chester.
Oh?
Drink your brandy.
Oh, thank you. Well, at least this time it's a man.
Just what do you mean by that?
You know what I mean.
Are you bringing up that thing again, throwing Alice in my face? You never forget Alice, do you?
Do you?
Why, you damn mean imitation Napoleon. You're a fine one to talk. That's priceless.
Yes?
How about you and Steve Hagen?
What about me and Steve Hagen?
Every time I see you two together.
Steve and me?
As if you didn't know.
You say this about Steve? The funniest man that ever lived. And me?
Are you so dumb? You lived this long without even knowing
you. You have no right to say such things about Steve.
Don't put that down. Don't. Oh, God. Oh, please don't. No.
Pauline! Pauline, get up. Oh, God. Oh, my God. My God.
She was killed at 10:30 Saturday night. I didn't hear about her murder until I read Monday morning's newspaper. For her, it was over. For me, it was just beginning. I didn't know what hell was about. But I was to find out.
You are listening to Mutual's presentation of The Zero Hour.
Tomorrow at this time, rest your eyes and listen here to this week's continuing study in suspense. Desperate Witness.
I'm Rod Serling. George Stroud, husband, father, executive editor of Crimeways magazine. A restless man, never quite satisfied with what he has. Bill Jonoth, arrogant, pedantic publishing mogul, Stroud's boss. Pauline Delos, ice blonde, cool, the boss's mistress. George Stroud, Earl Jonoth, Pauline Delos. Three sides to the eternal triangle that meet but for one moment. The formula is timeless. The connection is murder. And for George Stroud, like the taut mainspring of a clock overwound, life itself is about to explode on the hour. Our story, Desperate Witness, continues after this word.
I had intended going straight home, but after I saw Janet go into the apartment with Pauline, I felt the need to wander a while in limbo. Up to that point, I'd meticulously kept my wife and my family in one niche in my life and Pauline sealed off from them in another. To go home irritated with the thought of Pauline and Janet being together was to somehow overlap the two, spoil the waters, so to speak. So I went back to Gill's, where I could have an anonymous drink and dull the churning within me that Janet had set off. The night was a couple of hours older when I drove into my garage on Marble Road and went into the paneled, comfortable suburban house with all its little scars of family living. The painting I'd bought, The Temptation of Judas, I simply laid down on the dining room table. It would have to be cleaned, repaired, and framed. I'd made a pot of coffee and I thought about my wife and daughter who'd be returning tomorrow, Sunday. So help me, that's all that was on my mind when I fell asleep. Not knowing that Pauline was dead. Murdered. If I'd known what was happening back in the city in Steve Hagen's apartment, I wouldn't have closed my eyes.
Coming.
Earl, come in. What is it? What's wrong?
Close the door, will you please hurry?
What is it? Sit down. I'll get you a drink.
Steve, I just killed Pauline.
You should have killed her years ago.
Well, I do. I go to prison, Steve.
Stop it. Who saw you come here?
Huh?
Here. Anyone see you?
Well, I don't know. I don't think so. I hit her over the head with something. A decanter, I think. Maybe 3, maybe 10 times.
Fingerprints?
Oh, I wiped them off and off the doorknob. And the doorman wasn't on duty when I went in or when I came out. I killed her. I didn't intend to. It's just... Well, it's the pressure. I didn't get anywhere in Washington. Jonathan Enterprises is in real trouble. What am I going to do, Steve? The SEC's after me. Jenna Donahue's trying to force me to merge and sell.
Forget all about that for now. You sure nobody saw you go into her apartment?
Who's that?
Steve Hagen here.
Oh, Mr. Hagen, I hate to bother you at home. This is Emery Mafferson.
Well, what can I do for you, Emery?
Well, I just heard a disquieting rumor that the magazine's going to fold.
Mr. Janeth's right here. We've been in conference over the same stupid rumor. Hold a minute. I'll let you talk to him. Go on, Earl. Talk.
But who is it? Who is he?
He works for us, Future Ways. Tell him the rumor he heard is false. Everything's okay. His name's Mafferson. Emery.
Hello, Emery.
Oh, hello, Mr. Janeth.
Look, a lot of false rumors floating around. All that talk. I don't want you to believe a thing.
Oh, great. I feel relieved, Mr. Janeth.
Well, it's good to talk, Emery. Anytime, and keep up the good work. What was that all about?
You just established your alibi. When the police investigate you, as they will when your relationship with Dulles comes out, we have the testimony of Mafferson that he talked to you in my apartment at... What time did you kill her?
No, I don't know. 10:30?
10 minutes of 11. And they'll have your chauffeur's testimony. He dropped you here right from the airport at 10. And mine that we've been in conference ever since. And since no one can identify you as having been in the building...
There was someone. Someone did see me.
Saw you go in?
Yes, a stranger. He was just leaving Paul in. They'd been away together. For the evening. Maybe for the weekend. That's why we quarreled. That's what started the whole thing.
Did he recognize
him? Well, I don't know.
Did you recognize him?
No, he was in the shadows. I couldn't tell much. But she said his name was George Chester.
One man in the world saw you go into her building and you don't know who he was? Whether he knew you or recognized you?
Well, I don't know. I don't
know. Gotta find him before the police.
How can we do that?
What do we employ 2,000 people for?
Well, if we find this man, then what?
It all depends. When the story breaks, he may go straight to the police. In that case, our alibi stands, and our line is this. He says he saw you on the scene. Well, what was he doing there? That makes him as hot as you are. We'll make him even warmer.
Of course. You mean only to scare him off?
If he doesn't scare, the case goes to trial. You've got an alibi.
But if he doesn't go to the police the minute this breaks, then what?
He's a constant threat to your safety, your position in life, your place in the world. Can you put up with an intolerable situation like that?
I don't like it. There's already been one tragedy. I don't want another. Not if I know what you mean.
You know what I mean.
No. No, I won't see a man killed in cold blood. I won't take any part in it.
Let me ask you, Earl. Are you ready to retire to a penitentiary and write your memoirs? Or are you ready to take your full responsibilities along with the rewards? No, we never went to murder before. But we will this time, if we have to.
I killed her. I can't get that out of my mind. I killed Pauline.
When you break, a lot of other people break, too. Whenever an entity like Janeth Enterprises goes under, and that's what this could trigger, a lot of innocent people, their plans, homes, dreams, aspirations, the future of their children, all of that can go to pieces with it. Myself, for instance.
Well, I understand, Steve. All right, what has to be, has to be.
Now, let's get to work. Finish your drink, and we'll start from the top again. I want every step, every word. You got out of your car, you sent your chauffeur on, you went into the apartment with her.
I knew none of this when it was happening. I awoke in the morning and went to the train to pick up my wife and child. I hadn't even dreamed in the night, and my world was coming apart. Monday morning, and Georgette came back to the breakfast table from taking our daughter to the bus.
George, have you seen the paper? There's a dreadful story about a woman we met, I think, at Janet's.
Sitting there in the sunny breakfast room, fresh-picked yellow roses on the table, I read it. Not understanding it, not believing it. I had to read the headline twice. But the picture was of Pauline. Her body had been discovered at about noon on Sunday. Her death had been fixed at around 10:30 the night before. Saturday, I had just left her minutes before.
Isn't that the same woman?
Yes. Yes, it is.
She was beaten to death with a heavy decanter.
I'm reading. I was grateful to have the paper to hide behind. My hands were shaking as I read the words. No arrests had been made, the paper said. Her immediate friends were being questioned, Earl Janeth among them. But the publisher had not seen her for several days. He had just returned that night from Washington and had gone straight from the airport to a business associate's where he spent the evening in discussion. The business associate was not named.
George? Something the matter?
What? Oh, no. No, no, darling, nothing.
Well, don't look so grim. By the way, I didn't tell you I like that new painting you brought home. The one of the two hands, but it's in terrible condition. Another Patterson, isn't it?
Perhaps.
George, you don't have to be so monosyllabic. Can't you say anything but yes, no, perhaps? Where'd you get it?
Just picked it up. Honey, I'm trying to read the paper. Pauline and Earl Janeth went into that building at 10 o'clock on Saturday night. Now he claimed he hadn't seen her for days. He had to have been the one who killed her. Had he recognized me? If he had seen me that night, it would all come out. The weeks with Pauline, the lying, the whole sordid story. My life, my career, my marriage, family. All threatened. He killed her.
He had to have been the one. How strong was his alibi? Could he make it stick? And if he did, where did that put me?
On the train going into town, I read every newspaper, virtually memorizing what was known of the murder, but gathering no real information. It was warm in the city. Unseasonably warm. But I was... It was cold. My hands, I noted, were white. My fingertips bloodless. In the mirrored elevator, I found myself staring at the strange face that was my own. Not a face, really, but a caricature. Lines like deep cuts that hadn't been there yesterday. Pallor. Mouth slightly open, breathing shallow. All unmistakable signs of fear of a man in a desperate panic. I had 26 floors to gain control. When I stepped out of the elevator, I was wearing the mask, the facade of the confident, secure executive. Morning, Lucille. Any calls for me?
Steve Hagen's called twice. Better get right up there.
Well, why? What's up?
I don't know, but you know Hagen.
Nobody knew Hagen. He was a hard little man whose soul had been hit by lightning. His mother was a bank vault, his father a computer. Steve Hagen was almost as loyal to Janet as to himself. From what I knew of their backgrounds, Hagen was the kingmaker, Janet the publications genius. But Hagen was the steel foundation that held things together. Everything about Hagen's office was designed to throw you on the left foot. I hadn't been privileged to enter his sanctorum often, but every time the same thing happened. At loss of confidence. You opened the door and you saw him across an acre of office. A small man sitting at a huge raised desk. He didn't look up, which was part of his style. I started across to him, trying to remember exactly where the drop was. You couldn't see it from the door. The carpet was patterned and disguised it, but there was a step down. And always it came as a jolt. You started across in confidence and suddenly, abruptly, found yourself walking out into space and grabbing at the air. And you spent the rest of the distance trying to regain your equilibrium and your poise. You lost on both counts.
Morning, Stroud.
Oh, good morning. Morning, Steve.
Stroud, anything on your agenda at the moment you're to drop?
Oh, everything?
Your staff can handle things. I've something more important for you.
Mm-hmm. If you say so. Oh, by the way, I've just read about that Pauline Delos murder. It's pretty awful. You any idea?
Yes, it's bad. No, we have no idea about it.
Hmm. Well, I suppose Janet is, who else?
He is, yes. But I don't know any more about it than you do. Now, I have some prepared notes here, so let's get to work, huh? We have a job on our hands. Not hard, but delicate. It seems you're about the best man on the staff to direct it.
Yes?
In essence, the job is this. We want you to locate somebody unknown to us. Really, it's a missing persons job. Would that be all right with you?
Well, missing persons seems to fit in with the essence of crime ways, and that's my job, crime ways.
Of course, of course.
Who is it that you want me to locate?
We don't know.
Oh?
Let me see now. Let's start at the beginning, shall we? The person we want went into some Third Avenue bar and grill called Gill's last Saturday afternoon. It's a weird kind of bar, more a museum.
He wasn't looking at me. He was studying his notes, or he'd have seen the sweat that popped out on my face. I could feel the trap being sprung for me. I fought a rising nausea. My cheek muscles formed a slight smile that froze into place and gave me, I hoped, a look of complete concentration. But my mind was racing at light years speed as he reeled off my actions on the day of the murder.
This man we're looking for, Stroud, was accompanied by a rather striking blonde, also unidentified. They later went to a Third Avenue antique shop. In fact, they browsed through several, but in one they... That is, he bought a painting from a dealer, overbidding another customer, a woman who also wanted to buy it. The picture was by an artist named Patterson. According to our morgue,
somebody had done a quick and thorough research job on Patterson. He had all the details, how 10, 12 years back she'd been hailed as a meteor in the art world, that she'd never fulfilled her promise. In recent years was totally unheard of, although her work maintained value. He had all the details of my transaction. He knew the painting depicted two hands was in rather bad condition, and that I'd bought it for $50.
After they bought the painting, the man and the woman with him went to a cocktail lounge in the Van Barth for a few drinks. It's possible he checked the picture there. He may have had it right with him.
Why do you want this man, Steve?
We think our party is a vital figure in a business and political conspiracy that's reached colossal proportions.
You mean threatening Janeth Enterprises?
Exactly. What this man represents could destroy Earl Janeth. And we can't let that happen, can we?
So, what do we do?
Well, we just have to find this man. We can't have him loose, threatening all our existences, can we? Oh, as we understand it, his name is George Chester.
I understood it all now. Pauline had given Janeth the full rundown of our Saturday night activities. And had she told him where we spent the night Friday? They'd probably had a violent fight about it, and he'd killed her and gone straight to Hagen. Then Steve Hagen was the business associate the newspapers mentioned who provided Janeth's alibi. It was plain Janeth knew he'd been seen and was afraid he'd been recognized. The ground I was on felt landmined. One step the wrong way. It's all pretty vague, Hagen. Can't you give me more to go on?
You're right, Stroud. It is vague. Our information is based entirely on rumors and tips and certain, well, striking coincidences. When we locate our man, then we'll have something definite for the first time.
Well, what's it to be? A story for Crimeways?
No. No, I don't think so. I don't know right now just what our angle will be when we have it. We might want to give it a big play in one of our books eventually. A good story should never be wasted, right? Or we might decide to use it in some entirely different way. It's all up in the air.
Well, tell me, who else is in on this? Should we cooperate with anyone? The cops, for instance?
No. No, of course not. Absolutely not. This is our story, exclusively. It must stay that way. You'll have to go to other agencies for information, naturally, but you get it. You don't give it. Is that perfectly clear?
Yes, I understand.
Now, do you think you can knock together a staff as large as you want and locate this person?
It would be easier if I knew more about this mystery guy, what he looks like. Somebody must have described him.
Well, not too well, but we do know he's of average build and height. Weight 150 to 180, under 6 feet. It's possible he's in advertising. But your best bet is this place called Gill's, or the shop where he bought the picture, or the bar of the Van Barth. Oh, and that picture he bought. Perhaps the artist. I have a feeling that picture alone might give us a break.
Not impossible.
We want this guy in a hurry. Can you do it?
You say his name's Chester, George Chester?
It might be, he might not.
Oh, that's a start.
Then you go to work immediately?
All right, Steve. I'll take the assignment. I have absolute carte blanche?
Absolute. Expense, personnel, everything. In every way except time. We want him now.
He got up from the high back throne and wandered to the huge plate glass windows that looked out over about 10 million people. I hadn't suspected this cold, dried man would have had such a sense of drama. He took a long pause and he swept his hand out, indicating the city far beneath us.
Our man is out there somewhere, Stroud. May even be very close for all we know. It's a simple job for a mind like yours. Get him.
I looked out the window myself. Get him, he said. Find him. I had found him. The man I sought was looking back at me. My own reflection in the plate glass. I'd been assigned to set myself up to be murdered.
You are listening to Mutual's presentation of The Zero Hour.
Tomorrow at this time, rest your eyes and listen here to this week's continuing study in suspense, Desperate Witness. I'm Rod Serling.
Today's episode brought to you in part by General Motors and Contact. This is the Zero Hour on Mutual Radio. You have been listening to The Zero Hour, a presentation of the Mutual Broadcasting System in association with Hollywood Radio Theater, heard every weekday at this time. Rod Serling is your host. Zero Hour is produced and directed by Elliot Lewis. The Hollywood Radio Theater theme was played by Ferranti and Teicher and is now available on United Artists Records and Tapes. Hugh Douglas speaking. Tune in tomorrow and once again,
rest your eyes and listen here
to The Zero Hour. This is the Mutual Broadcasting System.